These past few years have given us plenty of material for stories, dystopian futures, and whatnot. And we do have another one to talk about today. It is a new book, and it's a little bit different from others you might see, because it really does tie in and use what we've been going through. The book is called House on Fire. It is from Matt Battaglia, who joins us today to talk about it. Matt, welcome to the program. Thanks for being here, sir.
Thanks for having me on.
So this particular book is dystopian future, but dystopian future in a way that I don't think we've really run across as much, because of just how much it incorporates what we've been going through the last couple of years. Do I have that right? Have I read those descriptions correctly?
Yeah, that's very true. There's no zombies. We haven't gotten to zombies yet in the world of House on Fire, but we are maybe 10 years away from them in the book.
So take me through just the basic premise of the story here, because you have your protagonist who's dealing with pandemic and the fallout from all of this. And where do we start? What is the story actually that's being told here?
Yeah, at its core, House on Fire is kind of a love story, in that it is about what... what you will do in order to save someone that you love, and what lengths you'll go to. The trappings of it is dystopian future. It was my way of processing and dealing with the pandemic, lockdowns, and all of the government oversight that came with it. It is also part warning, I guess, of what might happen again, and hopefully it'll be part of our cultural record of the moment that was 2020 through, I guess, through till still to today in some ways.
Right. It doesn't feel like it's ever going to end on sometimes, doesn't it? It's just, it's like, oh, of course we're going to do that now. I keep saying that my 2023 bingo card is fill in the blank, because things just keep rolling out, and it's almost like, well, there's going to be a sequel. You know, the other shoe is going to drop, and we're going to have more to this. It's really interesting artwork, though. It's very stark. You've got the black and white with the orange highlights. Was that a particular creative decision driven by any motivation?
Yeah, the illustration style was meant to be fast and immediate, and I was hope that the way that it was drawn would also tie into the mood and the emotions of the book and would accentuate that. The orange tone also was to serve that. I never wanted to make it a full color book, and I like having a tone to give some more definition to the art. And initially I was just going to go with a gray tone, but my publisher Sean at Living the Line Books suggested to go with that hot orange tone, and I think it added a lot to the book and built up a lot more tension as well.
Well, it does give it a certain particular type of energy, I think, because, you know, with graphic design, certain colors evoke certain emotions, and the orange, of course, is one of the hot colors, one of the more energetic colors. And in the world of the post-apocalyptic scenario, like you're talking about, orange is also used for any kind of fire-related products. So your fire starters, your candles, your flamethrowers, I mean, all of those different things, your prepper categories get color-coded, and orange is for all of the heat stuff, you know, matches and whatnot. So I think it's kind of appropriate here, because you're diving into how you survive this, you know, the aftermath of it. How much of you is in this story, though? You talk about this being a coping mechanism almost. How much of this is Matt's story?
There are sadly, a lot of similarities. I wouldn't call it an autobiographical story in any way, shape, or form. However, the book is informed by real life and things that happened either to me or things that occurred around me. I mean, I think all of society experienced the pandemic in one way or another. So my hope with the book is that it is relatable to anyone who reads it, because there should be some level of universality to the themes and the problems in the book.
Right. Was there a particular challenge when you were coming up with the idea of the story? It's like, how am I going to tell this story? How do I write this in a way that's relatable? And you talk about this being a time capsule almost. There's the challenge of making the story something that people can relate to, can understand 10 years from now, 15 years from now, 20 years from now. I mean, the people that are going through it now, we can read this and go, I know exactly what this is about. How do you transcend that? What were some of the challenges to making sure that this thing would not be dated 5 years from now?
Well, for one, I hope that I've transcended that. Time will tell if I actually achieve that.
Sure.
Again, and it's why I kind of framed it as it is. There is an emotional core of you know, a man trying to just go and get medicine for his wife, which I think is a you know, problem, a thing that will be relatable to anyone who is any sort of relationship from here till the end of time, and the question of what are you willing to do to save that person that you love. So I hope that that gives it something of a timeless quality. It's also in the pantheon of kind of like the road movie or the road book, where, you know, man has to set out on a journey and has to make it back home and is changed by the time he comes back.
Right.
And that's a pretty timeless tale. Yeah. There are plenty of examples of that throughout our sort of history. So my goal was to comment on today, but not make it specific. COVID's never mentioned within the book. It's not really it's a reaction to COVID, but it's not about that in that sense. It's not specific in that way.
Now, when you talk about, you know, other stories that have done the similar kind of thing, The Last of Us comes to mind. You've got a number of different post-apocalyptic scenarios. Did you try to avoid tropes? You know, oh, I can't do that. Everybody's done that. How do you make yours distinct? Or was that even part of the process where you're just like, well, I got to make sure that it's different enough? Or did you even worry about that?
I didn't worry about it. It was something where when I was making it, I basically just wrote out an outline and just started making pages. And the book started as something for myself. So I was really just, you know, concerned with making something that was for me. So I wasn't too worried about, oh, am I getting too close to this other thing?
Right.
I haven't watched The Last of Us show yet. And I played like the first 10 minutes of the video game before I forgot where I was when I picked it back up again at some point. So, but it's not dystopian in that way. I didn't go that far with it. So I wasn't too worried about stepping on other things' toes, because I don't think it's that kind of book. And I think comics frees you up to do a lot of things where you're not, the narrative isn't the only part of it. It's how you tell the story and how it looks and how it feels. So there are a number of other elements that are beyond just plot that I think make it compelling. Right. I hope.
Well, and you say you were doing this mainly for you. What was this, more of a think piece academic exercise? Did you have an intention to publish it from the very beginning, or was this something you finally looked at and you went, you know, this is good enough, I think I'll put it out there in the world?
For me, it was, I made the first page of it in 2020, and I put it down, and then I kept coming back to it. And usually when that happens with an idea, it means it's worth pursuing if I keep coming back to it and revisiting it and trying to make work it out. So I wouldn't say it's a think piece. I've been drawing and making art since I was little. And so for all throughout my life, making art and specifically comics has been how I process the world. And so in that way, House on Fire was just another example of that and another, you know, avenue for me to deal with what's going on in life. So fortunately, I had met Sean at Living the Line and I had sent him where I was and he was interested in publishing it. It kind of just worked out that way, which is great because I would like other people to read it. I think it has something to offer people and to offer readers that, you know, so I would like it to get out into the world.
Now, the title House on Fire, of course, evokes certain images and certain thoughts, and you talk about this being a reaction to things that have been going on the last few years. There is a concern among certain fan groups and the comics industry about, you know, our stories being too preachy, being too lectury. Did you try to avoid? Did you sit there and go, maybe we got to dial this back a little bit? How much of this is I'm telling a story to entertain? How much of this is I've just got to get something off my chest?
Well, I think it's both. It's funny because I wouldn't frame House on Fire as being entertaining. It's not a happy book, I don't think.
Sure.
I think it's good. But
well, let me rephrase. Not necessarily entertaining, but an effective story. Mm-hmm. You know, even if it's something that just, you know, makes you sit down and think. As a story as opposed to a message fiction type of thing, you know, making those distinctions.
I definitely don't view House on Fire as a message book. I tried to keep it. The reason why it's as sparse as it is that I would like the reader to be an active participant in the book. A lot of people, now that reviews are coming out and people are reading it, a lot of people are getting different things out of it. And so to me, I kept it loose in that way. So that way people can insert their own fears and worries into the book,
right,
and hopefully think about things from that perspective. I really don't want to preach to people. There is, you know, it obviously is about COVID and my reaction to COVID, but I don't mention COVID within it. I don't even think I mention lockdowns in it or anything like that. It's sort of the trappings of the world, but it's not specifically about that. It's supposed to be a little bit more of an emotional reckoning with the time.
Right.
And my hope is that makes it more lasting than if it were specifically about COVID per se, you know?
Right. Now, you've also got a book called Ghost of the Carousel, mm-hmm, that's out, and you're an organizer. You're, I think, a co-founder, am I reading this right, of Free the People, which makes documentaries?
Executive producer. There,
executive producer.
Yes.
All right. So what is it that you're doing there? Are these two related at all?
I don't think I would have made House on Fire if I haven't worked with Matt Kibbe and the people at Free the People for... You know, I've known Kibbe now for a decade. And so his, you know, that relationship is very key to where I've gone creatively in a lot of ways. So the work at Free the People, I think, has fed into my comics work in a lot of different ways. At Free the People, I did direct a documentary called All We Have, which was about a bar in New York and what they went through throughout COVID. And I view House on Fire as in part an extension of that, whereas All We Have is a literal factual representation of what happened, and House on Fire is a fictional, you know, reckoning with it. So, yeah, that's sort of how the two feed into each other. They're not related in a technical way, but I think that emotionally they're very similar.
All right. Now, where can people find this book?
Anywhere you buy books, you can go into a comic shop and have them order it for you if they don't have any copies on the shelf. You can buy it on Amazon. You can get it on Barnes & Noble. It is available in bookstores everywhere. If they don't have it in stock, you can have them order it. You can also get it on livingthelinebooks.com as well.
Okay.
Or you can go to my website, mattjbatt.com, and I have links to everything there.
All right. The book is called House on Fire, and it is by Matt Battaglia. Here is his website, mattjbattaglia.com, and he's also, House on Fire is also over at Twitter, and you've got a Tumblr presence, I see. It's,
apparently.
I don't know if anybody's
still alive.
Still alive. And of course, the freethepeople.org is the organization there. And we'll put a link to all of those in our notes so people can find you there. Matt, thanks very much for being here to talk about the book. Good luck with it.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me on. And we will have you back for your next project. We'll circle back in your next post-pandemic apocalyptic something.
It's going to be about technology. Spoilers.
Oh, that'll be fun. All right, thank you, Matt.
Thank you.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV.